opinions, viewpoints, and beliefs presented on this program do not necessarily reflect those of the management, the affiliates and broadcast partners, or the sponsors. Listener discretion is advised.
Scarefest Radio, the radio you can see.
Hey everybody, welcome to Scarefest Television. I'm Wes Forsyth, and I'm coming to you live from deep within the quarantine zone. And we're back at it. The original broadcast date is April 17th, 2020. Tonight, Coyote, in just a few moments, Coyote Chris Sutton will be talking to Mr. Josh Hurd, paranormal investigator, author, lecturer, and a whole slew of other things that he does. Tonight on the show, stick around. We got Josh the first half hour, then coming back from commercial breaks, second half hour, the winners of the Contagion Mask Contest. I think I found all the entries that we judge from and have a little slideshow for that, but we will be announcing the winners and tonight's prize. First place is like $75. Yeah, $75. We had a donation to up the prize money, and so we're paying grocery bills. It'll be $75 in a gift card to the grocery of your choice, preferably Kroger, because that's an easy one. Also, tonight we'll be having a little tribute to one of our founders, Mr. Chuck Starr, who passed away recently. And at the end of the hour, we have a little horror short film coming to you, brought to you by Neville Brett Smith. It's called Little Smokies. It'll be a lot of fun. Okay, Chris, tossing over to you.
Thank you very much, Wes, and thanks everybody for tuning in. And I got my buddy Josh here, Josh Hurd. Josh, how's it going tonight?
What's up, brother?
Not much, man. How you doing?
Not bad. Where's my money?
Hey, listen, I'm freaking air, man. You're asking me that stuff on air.
I'm going to ask you. Like, this is the only time I get to talk to you. Where's my money?
Dude, listen, you tell this, the lawyer said, the judge said I paid a certain amount of money. You tell baby mama.
I can't even keep a straight face. Dang it. Oh, man. This is so great, though. So great.
This is Josh Nightcon. Let me set this up first. Josh and I have known each other for a few years now. So back when we were in Cedar Rapids, it was like last year before last. I think it was last year, year before last, something like that.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
And Josh is down the aisle from me, and I've got my table there. And so I'm sitting there, and here up walks this very, very pregnant woman. And she comes over, and she leans down on the table and gets up in my face, and she goes, she looks down at her tummy and she looks back up at me. She goes, "This baby is yours." I'm like that, because my son Max is sitting next to me, and dude's counting money in his head like, yeah, you know, the old man had a little dalliance, and I'm not, if he's going to pay, I'm going to tell mom. And so I'm like, right. And so, I'm like, wait a minute, I don't even know you. She goes, "Oh, no, I was on one of your events one time, and by magic, I became pregnant." This woman is flipping insane. Dude, and I looked up, and there at least people are laughing at me. I'm like, oh, man. And that's how I met Josh's wife, Kirsten.
Yes, exactly. Oh, that was this has become like the best running joke ever. You know what I mean? I love it, bro. I love it.
I actually got to see Link last year. And so and Link was the baby, and he's a really great kid. But no, I mean, I'm really, dude, I'm always pleased to have you, to talk to you anytime, but it's even better to have you come on here and talk, because, you know, Josh is one of the most genuine people I know in the business, and always, you know, he's a good guy, he treats people right, and, you know, and so he's damn talented, too, so we're going to get into that in a second here, but, how's things going with the, you know, you make a lot of films and stuff like that, and I don't have any linear thing, I got some stuff written down. how's it with, you know, being had to stay around a lot of guys you want, let me work with, are kind of, you know, kind of grounded and stuff like that. What's the creative process going? How's it going today?
You know, not too bad. You know, it's crazy. Like this whole like quarantine thing, I've never been busier. I don't understand it exactly what's going on with all of this. Like today, I mean, this right now is like the third interview that I've done. And now, I mean, we just got done doing a live thing with the band. So I was playing music and all that stuff. So, I mean, super busy, but enjoying every second of it, you know. And when I'm not doing this, I'm editing like the G Crew episodes, yeah, and all of that stuff that we've been doing. So I've been keeping like super busy, that's for sure.
Yeah.
So I don't know if it's the downtime that we all are able to kind of come together a little easier now.
Yeah.
Collectively and share ideas, because we don't have the 9-to-5 jobs, or the majority of us don't have the 9-to-5 jobs to worry about, you know? Mm-hmm. So yeah, it's a different, it's a weird time. That's for sure.
It is a weird time, you know, Josh is a hell of a musician. You posted one time a song, I think it was Dead or Alive, or it was Living on a Prayer.
Oh, Living on a Prayer. Oh, yeah, man. Yeah.
Geez, that was good. It was an amazing, amazing song. So if you know, and Josh and I have always tried, like, dude, we're going to get together. We're going to play in the Malvern. We're going to get the spirits all cranked up. And every time we try to plan something, it falls apart. Or he gets to go do something. I got to do something, you know. And then this year we can't do, you know, I can't really do much of anything. So
I know, right?
We'll do that. We'll get that done someday. It'll be cool.
Dude, I can't wait for that day where we're able to, like, sit in a room together and just jam. You know what I'm saying? Like, invite my buddy Brad over here, who's the drummer and all that. And, I mean, my God, man, like, really have some fun with this, you know? So it's, but I mean, the day will come. That's for sure. Yeah, we'll be able to finally hook up. That's for sure.
I'm still alive, so we got a chance. So
you're still kicking, bro. You're
still freaking kicking. Okay. So since we're talking about creativity, last year, it was Into the Light 2 that you debuted at, it premiered at, in Hanukkah. We saw last year. Was that it?
So when we did Haunticon, I think we premiered A Brush with Evil 3.
Yes, that was it. Brush with Evil 3 with Dean Houser. Uh-huh.
Yes, yes. I had to refresh my memory for a second. I'm like, crap, I don't remember. I know.
But it was one of the coolest things. And tell everybody, you know, I thought it was really cool. It was like an experiment that you guys did a documentary on. And Josh does documentaries, does good ones. He's been part of 17 documentaries, but this is the one I saw. I mean, I've seen others. I saw Into the Light and I think two as well. But tell us about this whole thing with Brush with Evil 3 is just pretty cool, and how it worked out and stuff.
So yeah, like A Brush with Evil 3 was more of like just, I wanted to kind of wrap up the series. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It's like, we've done two films already. And then I decided, I was like, you know, what if there's something to the idea of spirits being able to kind of like travel and move from location to location? And so we took the team and we split us in half, and half of us went to the Sally House in Atchison, Kansas. And then the other half stayed here in Malvern Manor, where I'm at right now. And with the idea of actively eliciting a response from the other location. Now, the first hour of this experiment, of a three-hour-long experiment, the first hour was just, this is who we are, this is how we investigate. You know, no agenda whatsoever, no battery of questions, just go. If anything happens, awesome. And then we were going to, you know, through a series of isolation experiments and things like that, then the team in the other location was going to ask the questions and ask to elicit a response at the other location. And, you know, honestly, to my surprise, it actually worked, and I didn't really expect it to. Again, like, you go into a documentary film and you hope for the best, obviously, but at the same time, you have to kind of like set your sights low and be like, you know, because how often does paranormal activity actually happen to a degree that it's like, I don't know, like to a degree that's noteworthy, right? And so for that stuff to happen, I was blown away, honestly. I was absolutely shocked that happened.
You know, because the ghosties don't follow a script, you know. But, you know, tell me what happened. I mean, I saw it, but a lot of people haven't seen it out there. So
even during the first hour, where, again, it was just like, okay, Team A is over here investigating in Sally House. Team B is over here investigating at Malvern. And throughout this hour, they're able to go throughout or whatever. And what ended up happening was the activity started to mirror at the different locations. And we were experiencing the same things at the same time. Now, this was interesting, too, just because we weren't able to communicate with one another. We had no communication whatsoever. So this was paramount, honestly, for this to be happening 150 miles apart. Right. So that fascinated me. And obviously, you don't know that this stuff happened until the next day, which, funny enough, the next day I had an event to do. So I had to wake up early in the morning. Oh, God. I had to drive, like, I don't even remember how far I got to the event, and my phone is blowing up the whole time, but if I'm driving, I'm not answering. Right, you know what I mean? Like, it's just how I am. I'm kind of paranoid like that. But so I get to the location I'm setting up, and my phone is just going off like I'm having a telethon. They're like, "You're never going to believe this crap." Well,
they're watching all the evidence and stuff. And
they were, they were all seeing it and experiencing it and loving it. And I was just like, man, I guess I'll see it tomorrow, or at least when I hit the hotel room. But yeah, really cool stuff, though.
It was kind of cool, like you're the Malvern Manor guy, okay? That's your home spot. That's, you know, you're there. It's that place like your backyard. Well, what was cool is that you went to Sally, and Johnny Hauser went to Malvern. So he took the home field advantage out of it.
You know, and it was funny. Because Hauser, I initially wanted Hauser to be kind of like on my team, right? But he was like, "There's no way I'm walking back into that house. Like, there's no way." He's like, "I've experienced enough in that place. I'm never going back. I've made promises. I'm never going back." And I obviously, you have to respect that. So sure. I'm like, "Okay, cool. You stay in Malvern. You do your thing over here. And I'll cruise over to the creepy ass Sally House," which I had never been to before. I had driven by it a few times. I'd never been inside of it. And that place does not disappoint. If you guys haven't been there, definitely put that on your list of places to go. It's phenomenal.
Yeah. I mean, I know Ron and Denise Pridemore, who used to be tour guides there and stuff like that. Absolutely. And Denise was the one who was on Ghost Adventures when they did it and stuff like that. And she tells all kinds of stories, and they don't do it anymore. So, I mean, it's like, it's one of those places we had plans to go, and stuff never, you know, that happens sometimes. You know, it's like they don't want you there, so they screw things up for you.
Yes. Yeah. And that was kind of what I was afraid of, right? It's like you put all this planning into it, like months and months worth of planning, and you try to get every logistical problem out of the way just so it's handled, you know? You know, we show up, and it was my buddy Chris Case and myself who showed up, because dummy me, right? I always put too much on my plate, it seems, right? So
yes, you do.
We get there and we show up, and we set everything up, did a quick little test to make sure that they could hear what was going on in the house, and we could hear what was going on in that house, just so what there was that bridge. And then I had to leave the house and go do, I was speaking at the, I don't know what it's called. It was the town building or whatever over there. And so I had to go and lecture for an hour and a half, and then come back and film the dang documentary, because I'm a moron, you know?
Please, you're just trying to, you know, you always try to please people, and you try to give people, you know, what they want and stuff. And so I get that. That stuff happens.
Yeah, and I just honestly, like, the whole lecturing thing, like, I think I just like to tell stories, you know? Like, I think it's just fun for me. I love that stuff.
Yeah.
And so we're there, and we're setting everything up before, you know, we just rolled into town. We're setting up, and Chris and I are setting up the main area, kind of like in the kitchen of the Sally House. And there's a little, small little bathroom right off the kitchen, and we hear the water turn on full bore. And I turn around, and I'm like, well, that's in the restroom. So I walk over to the bathroom there. I see that sink is blaring. And I mean, it's going full bore. And I'm like, okay, that must be a weird water pressure thing. Sure. You know, I mean, that happens. And so I was doing whatever. And then I went to go do that lecture, you know, and I was talking to Maria, who ran the place at the time. Uh-huh. And she was like, that literally has never happened before. I was like, awesome.
You're in
for
it. It's
funny, too, because just then a few months down the road, I hook up with Steve Shippey, you know.
Yeah.
And so him and I start to become buddy-buddy. And he goes and he's filming an episode of Haunting in the Heartland at the Sally House. And he said the exact same thing happened to them. I'm like, get out of here, bro.
That's
like,
cool.
That is so cool for it to never happen. And then here it is happening to two of us. And we just happened to cross paths and share that story with
that's
one
what
another. It was really neat. Yeah.
Hey, that's cool. Hey, listen, it's time for a break. And so you're watching Scarefest Television. We'll be back in a few.
Everyone is talking about CBD oil, and it seems like almost everyone is using it. The research is ongoing, but the apparent health benefits are overwhelming. If you're going to use CBD products, though, what brand should you buy? First, find out where the hemp was grown. Imports are flooding the market. How potent is it? Look for a brand that plainly states its concentration on the label. And look for full spectrum CBD. This means the oil contains CBD and all the other cannabinoids, terpenes, and nutrients that are found in the entire cannabis plant. Look for Blue Leaf CBD oil. Blue Leaf Naturals is a Kentucky proud company. They use only Kentucky-grown hemp, supporting Kentucky farmers and businesses. Visit their website at blueleafcbd.com now and use the code SMILE at checkout for free shipping.
G'day Scarefest fans, Glenn here from fakeshemp.net. I hope you're all looking after yourselves. I hope you're not going stir crazy in those stupid bloody isolation chambers that you find yourself in during this stupid bloody crisis. Oh my god, times suck. Anyway, I'll tell you what doesn't suck, a movie I've got lined up for you today from 1984. I hope you like creature features because this one's about a giant pig. Razorback is a creature feature unlike any other, but it was actually ridiculed at the time of its release here in Australia. I guess it was just too absurd for a lot of people, but thank God time has been kind to it because it's now regarded as a bona fide classic. Often referred to as Jaws on Trotters as coined in a retrospective documentary about the movie, Razorback is about a giant pig that terrorizes a community in the outback of Australia. Narratively speaking, it's as simple as that, and there isn't much more to it. However, stylistically speaking, it is groundbreaking and jaw-droppingly visceral. And that is entirely thanks to director Russell Mulcahy. Razorback was his first feature film following a huge string of massive music videos for artists like Elton John, Duran Duran, Fleetwood Mac, AC/DC, and Paul McCartney, amongst so many others. And his approach to the film is why it's so good, because it has a massive music video sensibility. It's highly stylized and almost surreal. In fact, a popular piece of trivia is that his visceral precision even caught the attention of Steven Spielberg, who famously called him up to find out how certain things about Razorback were shot. And that's kind of ironic when you consider that Razorback was actually one of those post-Jaws cash-in movies. So yeah, the film does have quite a large cult following around the world, and if you haven't heard of it, or if you haven't even seen it, then it is available to rent or buy online at places like iTunes, Amazon, and YouTube. Unfortunately, it's not available on any of the streaming services. Therefore, as I always do, I encourage you to pick up a copy from Umbrella Entertainment, not a sponsor, down here in Australia, where their Blu-ray release is entirely region-free and will work on your players. Razorback is so good, and I really hope you're able to find that one. The director, Russell Mulcahy, went on to make films like Highlander and The Real McCoy and The Shadow and Ricochet and so many others, including one of my favourites, Resurrection, with Christopher Lambert. And yeah, he's a really cool director who's done lots of other stuff too. But anyway, that's it from me, a quick one today. I hope you're looking after yourselves. My podcast is every week. Always have to plug that. And in the meantime, I'll catch you next week.
And that was our mate Glenn Cochran, who comes to us from tomorrow about lunchtime. So good job, Glenn. All right, Josh, man, it's okay. You're a teenager. Your first paranormal experience, what happens?
Oh my gosh, man. So yeah, I just lost my uncle. Him and I were like very close, like best friends. And so I was kind of at that age where I just started to understand like kind of the finality of death, you know? So it was a very odd time for me anyway, but then like losing him was very hard. You know, he was quite young. He was only 31 years old. But he passed away. And then it was more like I had had enough of like family time and all that. So I wanted to kind of take myself out of the equation and just be alone. So I'm at my house and I'm walking around and I ended up smelling his cologne and it hit me so hard that I just froze in place. And I mean, the hair everywhere standing up, you know, and I ended up saying his name, you know, I said, Todd. And, you know, this warmth came over me and it was almost like he was just popping in briefly just to say hello and that everything was okay, you know, because like, again, like it was so hard for me at that time. I mean, it's hard for me to even talk about it now, you know, it's tough stuff. And that right there, though, that was my moment. That was my thing. Okay, something definitely is bigger than us. Something is going on that we're not privy to. Something is there. And I'm going to figure out what the hell it is. You know what I mean? Right. Like, I want to figure out what this is. And that's, man, I started to get into the works of like Hans Holzer, Ed and Lorraine Warren, anything parapsychological in nature. I'm reading this. I'm 12 freaking years old. And I'm like, I have a dictionary beside me because a lot of this crap, I'm like, what does that mean? And I have to look it up really quick and I have to go back and forth. But that, man, that's what set me on the path right there was that. That experience, you know, just amazing stuff. Amazing.
You know, it's almost like he's like, okay, I'm going to come back and show you it's all right. I'm okay, but I'm also going to set you into something, a passion that I see inside of you almost. It's like spirits will do that. You know, they'll come to us to do stuff like that. So it's just, it is just so cool. So you get into the paranormal. How did you end up? So you go from being a paranormal investigator and all that stuff. And if we had an hour or something like that, we'd definitely get into that more deeply. But let's skip forward to the Malvern Manor. So you end up with Malvern Manor. And why?
Yeah. You know, like we were across the street filming at the Classic Cafe, which, you know, plug here or whatever. Yeah, right. But because I eat there all the damn time. But like, seriously. But we were over there filming because they have their own slew of paranormal happenings. And there's a bar attached to the places. So, you know, with noise contamination, it really couldn't do much. And I ended up going outside and meeting the gentleman that owned this building now. And, you know, he's told me kind of a brief history of the place. He's like, I really don't believe in this crap, but there's definitely something that happens there that I can't explain. I'm like, cool. And he was nice enough to let us in. I mean, man, I was hooked. At that point, like it became like this really sick love affair, right? Gosh. Like almost an obsession. And it's like, I want to know more. I want to know as much as I possibly can with history and then trying to correlate data and history and all of that. You know, and it's, I mean, shit, it's taken 6 years now, but I mean, we're getting there. We're making these big leaps and strides now. It's amazing stuff.
It's funny how people, I've talked to so many people where they own the place or they're like the, you know, that had, you know, they're in charge of caretaking or whatnot. And, and that, but they, it's all about, they wouldn't know what to do with themselves if they didn't have that place. Dude, it's addicting.
It is, man. Like, honestly. And I mean, I look at what I was doing before this, right? And as I worked at a school before this, you know, and that was about it. And I didn't realize, like, I loved what I did. Don't get me wrong. Like, I absolutely loved it. And it was almost painful to leave that profession. But, man, now it's just like, this is what I'm meant to do, for sure. Yeah. This is why I'm here.
I understand. So tell everybody about the, some people may know about Malvern Manor, some may not. Tell us about the place. What's the deal with the Malvern Manor?
Yeah, so the building itself was actually constructed. It was the mid-1800s. It was But yeah, it was the mid-1800s. It was built. It was primarily used as a hotel. It ran as such all the way up until the 1950s. So it had a really good run as far as that.
Yeah.
It ran as that, like I said, till the 1950s. It then became a nursing home, or what we would consider to be a nursing home.
Mm-hmm.
It only ran until the 70s. So it didn't really... Nursing home didn't really last very long. And then in the 70s, it became a group home type of setting. So servicing any type of mental disorder you could imagine, really. I mean, it's things that are interesting because they would consider it a mental issue back then. Today, we just consider it fairly normal. You know, people with drug and alcohol addiction, you know, very common type ailments. Things that we see every day, people with Down syndrome, you know, and then there was people on the other opposite side of the coin. There were people that were DID or multiple personality. There was also people that were schizophrenic, even murderers are housed here. Like, this is a very eclectic group of people coexisting together for sure.
Imagine putting murderers in with a guy with Down syndrome. Yeah, exactly.
Dude, I'm telling you. I'm telling you, it's pretty interesting. That's for sure, man. Yeah, that's for sure.
Well, the laws were kind of loosey back then, so it's
it's just a whole other a whole other world.
No doubt. So you have one special friend there, I know, that you like, this very tall spirit that hangs out there.
Yeah,
it's taking a shine to you.
You know, and that's just it. Is like it's interesting, right? Because we were experiencing this phenomenon, the shadow man phenomenon, this giant, freaking tall, black humanoid figure comes racing at you down this long black hallway. And it's, I mean, that's the majority of the people that run out of this place. It's because of that, honestly. Myself included. I will not lie about that. Absolutely. I'm out of here. But it was interesting because it was the day after paranormal lockdown aired. A nurse got a hold of me and she said, "You're never going to believe this." And she said, "The gentleman that occupied this room where the shadow is kind of coming from, right? And he was 6'7". He was nonverbal, mentally deranged. He was he had killed a few people in the past. But his claim to fame was he would come out of his room whenever they're doing their bed checks and rounds and he would chase the nursing staff." I'm like, "You have got to be kidding me." Because we're seeing similar behaviors, right?
Right.
So to me, nobody's getting hit or scratched or punched, any of that crap. None of that is happening. So to me, it almost suggests maybe something residual in nature.
Sure.
With a residual type of haunting, though, there's usually like an antecedent, right? Something that would kick it into motion.
Whether it must be a trigger,
Yeah, exactly. A weather pattern, a moon phase, whatever. But we can't, we can't figure that out yet. And we're trying everything that we possibly can. We still have no idea why this is happening. And then there almost seems to be some form of intelligence behind it, which is equally as terrifying. But
dude, now, see, now you got me all wired up now. I want to come out and figure out what it is.
I'm fine with this. I'm totally fine with this.
Yeah, because I did mental health. I've been in mental health for years, you know, and I still do kind of suck shit. Yeah, let's do this. We'll talk about that later, but yeah, definitely.
I'm fine with that.
I'm challenge accepted.
Hell yes.
So, and there's so many, and you got this cool doll there.
Oh my God. So that doll actually now has left, right? And here's where it gets fascinating. So that doll was never our doll. That belonged to somebody else, and they wanted us to hang on to the doll because of the activity in their home.
Right.
I'm fine with that, whatever. And I always, with the preface that this is always your property, I will just hang on to your property. So one day she got a hold of me and she said, "Hey, me and my family would like the doll back. No problem.
It's like, come on over and get it."
I know. And I said that. And I was like, "I'm keeping this thing in a blessed case." It was blessed by, by a priest and a shaman. so this case is like very well protected. Now, she ends up taking the doll, no big deal. That night, we ended up having a group here, and they were live on Facebook. And they're up in Inez's room doing a live or whatever, and you see this doll leap off of this counter. Now, it doesn't fall because it's a porcelain doll, mind you. It's very top-heavy, so... I've done numerous fall tests now since, and gravity always takes the head. The head always takes over. Sure. And so it will always land on its head first. However, in this instance, it almost leaps off and it lands feet first. And I know this also because not only the video, but the feet shatter because, again, it's a porcelain doll.
Right.
So they were nice enough. They put it together. They glued it back together and taped it and all that stuff. So very interesting, though, that we would lose Rose. And on the exact same day, just a matter of hours later, then this other doll starts to act up. That doll, I ended up putting back in that case.
You had a case still.
Oh, yeah. And that case is, like, very special. Like, my grandfather made that case. And so I was like, there's sentimental value there. I'm going to keep the case, you know, for sure.
And you did. But that other doll ended up everywhere in the house being put in that box or in some strange sexual position. So,
what's weird. So weird. Right? Like, why would a doll do that? It's super nasty. Anyway, but yeah, like the positions that it would find itself in, like, I'm kind of a weirdo anyway, but like that even freaked me out. I was like, that's disgusting. Like, that's nasty.
Yeah, but if it freaked you out, it's true.
Dude,
it's so good talking to you. We only get a half hour, and that's cool. And we'll do this another time, and we'll just talk. And, you know, we'll get in that room someday and play. We'll go check out the big guy, and we'll have a good time sometime. But dude, Josh, it's always a pleasure talking to you, my friend. G-Crew on, what's it on?
So if you go to patreon.com/G_crew, G-Crew, we're on Facebook as well, Instagram, all that fun stuff. But yeah, it's Nick Groff, Chad Lindbergh, Johnny Hauser, and myself. But yeah, and fun stuff, guys.
Josh drops the F-bomb at least 20 times an episode.
Oh, God, easy.
Okay, listen, brothers, good to talk to you. I got to turn back over. There's plenty of Scarefest television left, folks. Again, thank you to Josh Hurd, and it's time for our next break.
Thank you, guys.
Do you feel lost in life? Do you seem to be stuck in emotions that are not yours? Is your home not the sanctuary it should be? Contact Spirit Mechanics, where they take a team approach to your metaphysical and spiritual problems. Spirit Mechanics specializes in aura cleansing, stone attunement, attachment removal, and house cleansings. Spirit Mechanics tailors their approach to your individual spiritual path and needs. Now find them monthly at the Central Kentucky Mystical Market in Lexington, or on Facebook by searching Spirit Mechanics, that's MECHANIX. Spirit Mechanics, for your spiritual health and well-being.
This week in horror history, we begin with the cinematic directorial debut of Rob Zombie with the release of House of 1000 Corpses back in 2003. The first in the Firefly film series, House of 1000 Corpses introduces us to the deranged Firefly family, as well as Captain Spaulding and his Museum of Monsters. Although the film didn't receive a favorable response from critics, it went on to gather a cult following and was followed by two sequels and was even developed into a haunted attraction at Universal Studios. Undoubtedly, Rob Zombie brought a revival of true horror with this film, and it's true. The boogeyman is real, and you've found him. As the era of 80s slasher films was slowing and audiences were losing interest, the Friday the 13th series released what was supposed to be its final chapter this week back in 1984. Friday the 13th, the final chapter, picks up immediately where Friday the 13th Part 3 leaves off, where we see a presumably dead Jason Voorhees being led into the morgue. Jason spontaneously resurrects, escapes, and heads back to Crystal Lake to continue his murderous killing spree. Audience received the film with overwhelming praise, and the final chapter is viewed as the best in the series by many. Despite the franchise's attempt at putting an end to Jason, the film's success led to more sequels and helped to further cement Jason Voorhees into horror movie history.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Scarefest Television, the second half hour. So what we got going on now? This week we ran a contest on Facebook for the Contagion Mask Contest. Boy, I really should write this stuff down. Anyway, the Contagion Mask Contest. The concept was, show us what you're going to the grocery store in. Show us your most imaginative way that you're dealing with the contagion and with a little horror theme behind it. So what we did now, first I'm going to just go ahead and flip over to the slideshow here. I just want to drop some of these here. Not going to give shout outs too much. Except now this one we loved because using the blade in front of the mouth. We thought that was very imaginative. We always love pig pajamas. And so this one was a great one. That we had. Of course, this was our own Scott Kindred and the Purell on the claws just made it. This came all the way from Canada. And that is a Scarefest swag bag, I believe, that we see there. I don't have no idea what that rope is. Of course, in honor of the Tiger King, we had this lovely entry. I'm going to watch that one of these days. And then here are some people not technically following quarantine guidelines, but they're not getting too close together either, so I guess it counts. And then that one popped back up because it's a random thing. I don't know why it did that. Unless I could have two copies of it in there. No, it's just popping between the same ones now. We had several more entries. But I think all of our winning entries were shown. So we're going to announce now the winning entries for the Contagion Contest. You will be, Nicole Griffith will be getting in touch with you to find out the email address that you would like. There's one you haven't seen before. That you would like your Kroger or other grocery store gift card sent to. Yeah, I shouldn't have clicked that on random because I thought it would play through them in random order. And now it's just doing whatever the hell it wants. Okay, you can go back to me now. I think that was the most of the entries that we looked at. Everyone, first place winner, Tracy L. Pritt, for Shameless Pandering. She was the one with the mask with a little note on her head that said, get rid of this so that we can go to Scarefest 2020. The Shameless Pandering pushed her above the crowd into first place. Now, the other two are honorable mentions. It's not really a second and third because they both get the same prize. Incidentally, shout out to Todd Fulkerson. He actually donated money to this. We had our prize money. He donated more prize money. So first place is $75. That'll be a $75 gift card for Tracy Pritt. Then we have 40 and 40 going to Joseph Gavin Mann because everyone loves pig pajamas. I'll admit it. Me and another one of the judges just loved the pig pajamas. And then Scott Kindred, a Scarefest faithful, the hand sanitizer sold it, dude. The mask didn't do it, the surgical, but no, none of that did it. But having the hand sanitizer for the claws, that sold that one. So those are our prize winners for the Contagion Mask Contest. Now we're going to go over to Bonehead Humor here in just a moment. Bonehead Weekly. Change a damn name on me after you start. Bonehead Weekly with our movie review of the night from Joe. And then when we come back from the commercial break, we're going to have our little tribute to Chuck Starr. Then go into our horror short movie, Little Smokies, brought to you by Neville Brett Smith. Don't forget, Good Movie Monday, which airs here on Sunday at like 2 o'clock, which is really weird, but that's the way the earth works. And we'll be right back.
Hey, Scarefest fans, this is Joe Lewis from Bonehead Weekly, here with another review for another week during the COVID-19 isolation wonderland. Who's ready to go on vacation? Anyway, thank you so much. So, this is going to be a little cross-promotion. Sorry to Brandon and Wes and Nicole and everybody else. And hi, Anita. Anyway, next week on our show on Bonehead Weekly, we're going to have a special guest of Patrick Lussier. Patrick Lussier directed Drive Angry, which is a fantastic movie. If you've never seen it with Nicolas Cage. He also directed a horror film that I think is one of those where it's actually much better than the original, My Bloody Valentine, with Jensen Ackles from Supernatural. Anyway, so he has a new movie out on Hulu. It's called Trick. Now, the problem with Trick is it suffers from its budget. But I wanted to go through and say, if you got Hulu, you got an hour and a half. It has a twist ending. It's got Tom Atkins from Halloween 3. Love Tom Atkins. Patrick Lussier's career is very interesting. He started out as an editor for Wes Craven. In fact, he edited almost everything Wes Craven did from New Nightmare on. So that means he edited that first opening 10-minute sequence of Scream, that wonderful sequence of Drew Barrymore. Check out his work. He's a fantastic editor. But if you have to watch one of his movies, a movie I strongly suggest you try, check out, even though I think most of you know My Bloody Valentine, is Drive Angry. It came out in a theater with Nicolas Cage, Amber Heard, and it takes place of, it's, the story is this. He, Nicolas Cage, is a guy that's dead, and he comes back to seek vengeance. There's a cult leader. He has to chase down the cult leader. And there is this wonderful character actor named William Fichtner, who plays the accountant. And the accountant is a guy from hell who is there to chase down Nicolas Cage and bring him back because he's the accountant for hell. And he has some of the best lines of dialogue in any movie and delivers them perfectly. Drive Angry 3D. It's my favorite of Patrick Lussier's movies. And if you're interested, he also did a movie back in the early 2000s called Dracula 2000. I don't know that I recommend that, but it does have a young Gerard Depardieu. I'm joking. It actually has Jared Butler. I just like saying Gerard Depardieu instead. Patrick Lussier, check out his work, and I highly recommend a movie called Drive Angry. And I really like his My Bloody Valentine. It's ballsy. It has a five-minute sequence with a naked lady, which I know that's not everybody's bag, but check it out. And Jensen Ackles, both those boys from Supernatural, both got movies. And one of them got a good movie and the other one didn't. I know, I'm sorry to shit on the Friday the 13th remake here, but I got a little bit. The other one got My Bloody Valentine, which is also a remake. And that was pretty good. So Drive Angry. And if you have 10 minutes, check out. Or if you have an hour and a half, and believe me, you should have plenty of time. Also, as I'm looking at you, watching my audience, why are you looking at my head? Drive Angry, 3D, Trick on Hulu, and My Bloody Valentine. Patrick Lussier, talented filmmaker, really good guy. This has been Joe Lewis of Bonehead Weekly. Please keep staying safe. Hopefully I'll see you all October, whenever Scarefest is. And at that time, I'm still going to insist to not touch me and stay 6 feet away. Unless it's Wes, in which case, you can touch me.
Akashic Awareness is a metaphysical healing and learning center unlike any other. A large selection of crystals, gems, and minerals greet you as you walk in the door, but from that point onward, the journey is yours. They offer a great selection of metaphysical tools, state-of-the-art holistic healing, with classes and lectures scheduled throughout the month. Akashic Awareness is open Tuesday through Saturday, noon until 6:30, 7 on Friday and Saturday. Visit their website for a current calendar of their almost daily special events and guests at akashicawareness.com. And while you are there, be sure to join their email list to stay current. Akashic Awareness, 328 Sycamore Street, Elizabethtown, Kentucky.
Thank you. Coyote Chris Sutton.
Shamanism.
Spiritual advisement.
Paranormal investigations.
Inspirational presentations.
Bringing light to the darkest places for over 20 years. Go to CoyoteChris.com to learn more.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Scarefest Television. I do want to give a shout-out to Joe. Joe, next to Rachel Burry Booth, that was the second best offer that I've had today. So, everybody, what we're going to do now, one of our founders, Chuck Starr, passed away earlier this week. We want to, I'm going to read a little letter here. This was what Brandon Griffith, the new owner of Scarefest, posted on Facebook, and I don't think I could have done any better tribute to Chuck than what Brandon wrote, and I wanted to read that to everyone and do a little memorial here for Mr. Chuck Starr. We are saddened to announce that one of our founders and one of the pioneers of Scarefest, Chuck Starr, has passed away. In 2008, Patty and Chuck started the annual Scarefest for horror and paranormal fans in and around Lexington. Through their hard work and dedication, Chuck and Patty built a lasting foundation for years to come. I know personally I have many memories of Chuck and his running around on the scooter in his Indiana Jones attire with his signature hat and vest. I had the honor of hanging out with him in his office many times through mystical fairs and back when Nicole and I were getting inducted, so to speak. He offered advice, words of encouragement, and ongoing support. Many of us owe Chuck a great deal of gratitude. Because of his work and commitment, many of us were able to meet and build friendships, relationships, and in some cases, even marriages. As I often say, Scarefest has, in many cases, developed into a family of fandom, and as co-founder, you might say Chuck was its father. With that, we all have to remember that every year could be our last Halloween together. We all need to cherish our friends and family. Don't ever take anyone for granted and enjoy each other to the fullest extent possible whenever possible. We say goodbye to Chuck, but let his memory remind us that he helped create the very thing that brought so many of us together, and to cherish the time we have together. To never take for granted the one time a year we get to sit outside the Hyatt together until the wee hours, talk and share stories, enjoy one another's company, and build on those relationships. My dad said once that you may not remember what people say or what they do, but you will always remember the way they made you feel. Chuck made me feel welcomed, supported, and appreciative for the opportunities he offered. Our thoughts are with his wife, Patty Starr, who we all love and appreciate, and his children and family in this difficult time. We hope that they are able to find peace in their grief. With love and respect, Brandon Griffith, on behalf of the Griffith family and the Scarefest family. Stick around, everybody. Enjoy our horror short, Little Smokies, brought to you by Neville Brett Smith.
Maddie, come on in here. Your mama has something for you.
Yes, mama.
Come on over here. Your mama made you something special. Looky here. Little Smokies. Go on, smell of them. Taste of them. Go on, taste of them. They're so moist.
Oh, hey, Matt.
Hey,
how
Katie?
Are you?
Good, yeah.
I'll get out of your way. What did you bring this year?
Napkins, again.
Oh, great. Just put them down anywhere.
Okay. Cool.
okay, Matt?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm just gonna go get some air.
Are you sure?
Yeah, I'm good.
I don't like normal size food. Never have in my life. If I can't fit it all in one bite,
Matt,
get it out of my life. I don't like normal hot dogs. Give me little Smokies. I don't like normal hot dogs. Give me Smokies that are small.
Matt, what's up?
Hey, how's it going?
You off work early today?
Huh? Oh, yeah. Yeah, I am.
You want your usual?
Please. God bless. Hey man, there's something wrong with this drink.
Matt, are you feeling all right, dude?
Yeah, I'm good. Yeah, I'm fine, sorry.
You know what, I've been saving this for a special occasion, and I think you need it today. I've got a 22-year-old bottle of Agricole back here. It is one of the rarest, most expensive rums out there. Would you like to try it?
Okay, yeah, sure. Thanks. Oh. Oh, God. Oh, Jesus. No. No!
Oh. What the hell, man?
No, I'm not hungry.
Are you okay? You're acting really weird. Seriously, are you okay?
I'm seeing things that aren't really there.
Seeing things like what?
Little Smokies. Everywhere!
Seriously? I mean, maybe you need to try one, and then you'll see they're really not that scary.
Maybe. I don't even know if I could.
How about you calm down, have a drink, and do me a favor, put the baby to bed while I finish dinner.
Okay. No, you're my son. You're not a crockpot. You're my son. This isn't real. I'm going downstairs for a bit.
Thank you.
long smell.
Take and eat.
They're so moist.
Bad.
Don't know what all the fuss was about. Hey, Whitney.
If I can't fit it all in.